All right, let's talk a little bit about what led you to the book. First of all, social studies teacher, and then bachelor's degree, three masters, doctoral studies, all of the above. But love of history, love of education, love of learning.
What led me to that?
All of that.
Well, I like to tell my former students that I didn't actually get into history until maybe a senior in high school and then into college, when I read a book called Lies My Teacher Told Me, which you'll see those in some education programs. But essentially, what it did was open up my eyes to the history that I hadn't been seeing, that I'd been fed a particular narrative. But what was missing were all these other diverse voices that I could relate to more. So as a student, and then a future teacher, it was really about exploring history more in depth and revealing these hidden histories that I think are more, not only more accurate, obviously, but more inspiring. So that's my education journey, is discovering more.
Well, and you've helped us here at the Fraser with a website in this centennial year of the 19th Amendment. So our connection to you with that. And you've got this book on your lap, so hold it up.
So this
is your new book, Bluegrass Bold, Stories of Kentucky Women. You co-wrote, correct?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So we'll give Maddie her shout out.
Yeah, Maddie Shepherd was my co-author. She is a deeper learning resource teacher at Jefferson County Public Schools.
So tell me what led to this book, because I know, like you said, amplifying voices, those hidden mm-hmm. histories. So how many women are in this book, first of all?
There's not an exact number. There are 36 stories, but they represent bigger groups. The first story that opens up the book is Native American women in Kentucky. And we opened that book not only because they are the first Kentuckians, but that is a story that is particularly hidden in Kentucky history. For a long time, and it still lives today, there's this myth that Native Americans didn't live in Kentucky. So not only did we want to surface that story, but we really wanted to emphasize what was women's role in indigenous groups.
I love that. And I also want to talk about the quote, because I said, why this book? And there was a quote that I read by you that you used, and I thought that was perfect. So tell me the quote and who said it and why that struck you. There's a chord there.
The Toni Morrison?
Yes, yes.
Well, I'll try to get it right, but it was, if there's a story you want to be told, you should be the one to write it.
Yes.
Or if there's a book you want to read,
but it hasn't been written.
But it hasn't been written.
So what was it about that quote? Did you read that quote and go, oh, there's a lot I haven't. Is that what struck you?
Well, I think back a lot to when I was a classroom teacher, and we would talk about these dynamic figures of the civil rights movement or other, you know, presidents. And a lot of my students, no matter how smart they were, didn't always identify with that, with being able to take action and make a change. So when I came to this idea, that quote really communicated it well, because I realized there was a gap, there was a need in Kentucky where Kentucky history is dominated by a few central figures, primarily Daniel Boone and Henry Clay, and Lincoln was here once, so we claim him. But what about all these other stories that are
powerful? And where are the women?
Yeah, where are the women? Well, and particularly working with What is a Vote Worth, I would often talk to the groups and say, I used to tell people I didn't like women's history. And that was because I had such a narrow view of women's history, it felt isolated from my experiences.
And we didn't know it, right?
And we didn't know it. I got one day of it, I think. You know, it's often taught in isolation, and those stories didn't speak to me. And now they do, because I have a better grounding of the larger women's history.
But it's also because people like you are telling that story, I will say. Because I will say in 2020, I've learned more about stories about women that I never knew, and I'm double your age and then some, and it's embarrassing.
Yeah.
It's embarrassing, so thank you for correcting this problem that we have had, to say the least. Now, how did the stories come to you? Because it's very diverse. It's some go back in history, some are current, right?
Yeah.
So it's all over the map.
So one of the first women that we identified, which was part of this inspiration of these hidden stories, was Georgia Davis Powers. Was thinking about what a dynamic and important national figure she was, but also a leader in Kentucky. So some of them were ones discovered, whether working with What Is a Vote Worth or in other things I've been working on in Kentucky. So some names popped up. But then others required a lot of research. Talking to scholars, I reached out to dozens of people and said, you're an expert on Kentucky history. Please tell me, who are the dynamic figures that students need to know about?
And what's so good is this, you can only grow on, right?
Yeah.
There's volume one. We've already said
yeah.
there's going to be a volume two.
volume one, yeah.
What I love too with this, for instance, Georgia Davis Powers. So we tell her story, but you couple it with an artist.
Yeah.
Then there's the story of this artist, all female artists
yeah.
who do the drawings or pictures. Mm-hmm. I guess they kind of had free rein on how they would display or illustrate the person that they, I guess, I don't know how you coupled the artist with the person, so tell us that.
Oh, that was a process, yeah. So a lot of the women we feature in the book are lesser known leaders that we wanted to elevate, and we applied that same idea to our artists. So we reached out to professional artists as well as schools to have students apply to be an artist. What we did was, so we gathered all the applications, looked at the art samples, and we spent time thinking about how their style would pair with the different women's story.
Oh, so a lot of thought into
that. A lot
that.
Of thought.
Yeah.
It took a long time. And so it was all female artists. We wanted to make sure that we were having women depict women. But at the same token, we thought about like Nanny Helen Burroughs. Her story is about black womanhood and elevating black women. So we knew we needed to have a black artist mm-hmm. to depict her. It wouldn't make sense to have someone else.
So let's talk about some of the women that I wanted to do. So we talked about Georgia Davis Powers. All right, tell me about Mary Edwards Walker. I didn't know her story.
This is one of those where you ask yourself, how did I not know about this woman?
I didn't know either.
The only Medal of Honor winner that is a woman. She enlisted in the Army in Louisville during the Civil War. She was a surgeon, so also one of the earliest surgeons. But she was captured by Confederate soldiers and held for a good long while and was awarded the Medal of Honor after she was released. But one of the things we wanted to highlight was she was seen as a gender activist because she preferred to wear men's clothes. So she was arrested over and over. They tried to take her Medal of Honor away.
For wearing pants
and a top hat.
And a top hat.
So the only Medal of Honor winner is someone who isn't known. And yet, she has this really dynamic history.
Well, yeah, push back, right?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow. All right, let's talk about Ann Braden and Charlotte Wade. A lot of people might know Ann Braden's
yeah.
story, but what Charlotte Wade meant in that story mm-hmm. is key, right?
Yeah.
And you wanted to do both of those stories.
It made sense to me because Ann Braden obviously is a big figure, particularly in Louisville, and she did a lot of great work. But that story is not just Ann Braden's story. That she was a very powerful ally, but we wanted to elevate the bravery that Charlotte Wade and her mm-hmm. family endured in fighting redlining and fighting segregation. So we made sure to tell their story together. To show the power of this kind of cooperation to fight injustice.
And let's talk Tracy Drain. So that's more recent, and boy,
yeah,
is she making Louisville proud.
Yes. That was another easy one. We wanted to make sure that throughout the different stories, it's not just siloed to a certain type of female activist, that we have a lot of suffragists, we have civil rights activists, but we wanted to position students to see pursuing their passions and doing good in their community as a form of activism. So Tracy Drain's a great example where she's a scientist, you know, right. She's an engineer. And in that role, she is an activist by advocating for women in the sciences, but also thinking about how science is portrayed in the media.
Right.
So,
well, and with women. And now we're seeing so many more women in STEAM and STEM. And what I've been hearing so much recently about, you know, Kamala Harris and so many people talking about, you can't be what you can't see.
Yeah.
And that for Tracy Drain too, I think is so empowering to young women. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that I did this, you can do this. And there's something so powerful with that with kids, don't you think?
Oh, very much so. On that same vein, Margaret Ingalls is featured in here. She was an engineer, helped invent the air conditioner. She was one of the first women to graduate with an engineering degree in the country. And she spoke about paving the way for other women, but I think incorporating her story into a history class is so powerful to see how women have made a change in a way that isn't just marching in the street. As powerful as that is, I think it's also valuable for other people who that's not their jam.
Right. You know? Well, and it says all women are not cookie cutters,
yeah.
Right? They're, and the independent spirit that you see in this, that you can pave your own way and forge your own path, you know, and maybe you can be something that's not in there too,
yeah.
You know, kind
yeah.
of thing. I love that. And then the married couple that you have
yeah.
in there as well,
yeah.
their story is interesting.
Yeah, so Marjorie and Tracy, they are a couple that they were in Louisville, and they are the first lesbian couple to sue the federal government for marriage rights. They lived in Louisville. They got married on Main Street in Lexington, which is actually a very well-known strip in terms of LGBTQ history.
Do we
in
know
Kentucky.
About what year that was, roughly?
The 70s.
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 Okay.
And they faced a lot of backlash. I told you that we have their pseudonyms, but they were threatened. And
so we don't know their names.
Uh-uh.
And even in the picture is from behind because
yeah.
you said we don't really know their faces either.
We don't. And this was a place where, like I said earlier, it was really important to us to talk to scholars and make sure we're getting it right. So I reached out to several scholars in Kentucky who do LGBTQ history and said, what can you tell me about these real women? What did they look like? Do you have any pictures? And they gave a wealth of information, but they said, we don't have pictures.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
That really is interesting. So this book, like I said, multifaceted, the diversity of these women and the story is incredible. Let's talk about the foreword. I don't want to forget. You
yeah.
have a very special guest who did that as well. Tell us about that.
Yeah, Jacqueline Coleman, the Lieutenant Governor. We are particularly big fans of Jacqueline because she is from the social studies world. Maddie, my co-author, and I worked with her through the National Council for the Social Studies. So she was a former board member with us.
Well, and an educator. So
and an educator. So when we told her about this book and said, would you please write this, she was enthusiastic.
Well,
about
and
being able to do it.
And I noticed her closing words to everyone who reads the book, be bold.
Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of the message. What's the mm-hmm. takeaway that you're hoping that when people see this? What's the takeaway, do you hope?
A lot of different, you know, when people come to this book, they are going to be coming at it from all kinds of different backgrounds, geographies, interests. So, you know, one of the big things, like we mentioned, was we wanted to create a fuller Kentucky history that includes all of these voices. But also beyond that is I'm a strong believer in that you don't learn history just to know facts. That if you are going to know about the past, you need to know that and do something with that information. So we want, you know, kids and adults to pick up this book and see themselves as agents of change. And pursuing your passions, like you said, you know, bluegrass bold, we want people to feel emboldened to pursue their passions and promote a more common good in their society, whatever that might look like, whether it's, you know, as an entrepreneur, whether it is as a teacher or an artist.
And you're hoping this book, I mean, the the whole point of it is to bring this into the classroom. And you have a plan for that with resources for teachers and all that. One day when we learn about women's history, this could be really a catalyst for helping us do that.
Exactly. Former teacher, and my co-author is as well, and at present, my job is I'm the director of curriculum design for Summit Learning. So we wrote some complementary teacher-facing materials to help them integrate this into the classroom. So not only is it, you know, resources that helps them think about teaching with this book in terms of like the lesson level, but it also is incorporating the social studies standards that were passed in 2019.
I love that. Now, one thing you are looking for, and let's be real open about that because this is the chance to talk about it. You need some sponsorship money. Tell us how that works. You're looking really at a big sponsorship to help get it into the classrooms. Is that correct?
Yes. So education is not known for having a lot of money, you know, teachers buying their own supplies and things like that. So we really wrote this book for teachers, for librarians, for students to have in the classroom and use as a teaching tool. So we need some funders so that we can donate copies to school libraries as well as public libraries across the state. And then what we would like to do is some complementary programming to help librarians, teachers use this book and think of dynamic ways to bring it into schools, but then also help bring it out of schools.
Wouldn't it be amazing if there was a woman who was watching this who said, that's me?
That would be wonderful. Maddie and I, this has been such a passion project the last couple of years. I don't know if you can tell I'm enthusiastic about it. It's so exciting to see it come to life and to be able to have it in the hands of a lot of kids and maybe be inspired by one or more of the stories to then themselves take action.
And I noticed in the dedication, tell me who you dedicated the book to and why.
I wrote it to my mom, and now I'm going to tear up.
I know, but it was so sweet because I teared up when I read it, so I'm sorry. I had to do this.
Well, yeah, and I hid the book from her for a very long time. And, like, I mentioned I was writing a book, and I don't think my family really registered how much of a project it was. So my mother was, or is, she works with my dad, but she stayed home when we were little. And has three daughters. And so she, when she talks to my niece, she'll say, "I love you to the moon and back." And I thought about that particular quote and thinking about the women in this book, where we have a woman who works for NASA. We have engineers. We have these women who, my mom didn't become an engineer. She didn't become an artist. But she raised three daughters who never hesitated in pursuing those things. So, sorry, tearing up.
She had that spirit.
She had that spirit that never doubted, and I was so privileged to always have that backup in whatever I did. So I sent her the book for the first time like last week. And she's like, "Did you think I wouldn't read every word of that?" So that was a really special thing.
So I'm crying, you're crying.
I know.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you know what? Congratulations.
Yes, thank you.
And to your mama. Thank you, mama.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Amy.
Very good. Thank you so much,
Carly.
Thank you. Good luck.